Hi everyone, welcome to our colloquium. Today we are very happy to have Professor Gadadhar Misra from IIC speaking at our colloquium. Professor Misra is an operator theorist. He got his PhD from Stony Brook in 1982, and he spent a lot of time in ISI before moving to IIC in early 2000s. He has received many major awards, including the Bhatnagar Prize, J.C. Bose Fellowship, and he's also the fellow of all the Indian Academies of Sciences. So today we are very happy to have him speak on Grothendieck inequality.
Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here. Actually, I wasn't able to come to this campus, before this. In fact, almost complained, and I guess as a result, I am here. So, I'm going to do something rather unusual. Grothendieck inequality was proved by Grothendieck, of course, many years ago, 1960-something. The whole discussion and the topic was somewhat dormant from mid-70s to, I would say, early 2000 or something. In the last 10, 15 years, there have been tremendous interest in this inequality. And the connections that it has to many other areas of mathematics seem to be quite astounding. I mean, whether Grothendieck knew that this is actually such a fundamental inequality is hard to say, but I am going to sort of start in more recent times and go back to the point where there is a proof by Kirvine, which is actually rather beautiful, and that's the proof that's being refined today over the past many years again in trying to obtain a sharper bound for the what is called the Grothendieck constant. So I'm going to do things in reverse order, and although it's not quite usual, and one knows in colloquium one shouldn't be attempting it, but I have the proof of Kirvine at the very end, and I would like to actually show you the proof rather than just say that it's a beautiful proof. I will actually give the proof, okay? That I have decided after thinking about it for some time. So let's see how it goes. I'll try to do two proofs. One, a pictorial proof, proof by visualization, if you like, and the other one is the Kirvine's proof, and both are rather nice. So let's talk about where does this come from. As I said, I'm doing it in the reverse order. So let's jump in and think about what has been happening in the last few years with all the developments in theoretical computer science. Graphs and graph related questions have been playing a major sort of role in determining various questions or answering questions in complexity theory. This is one such. So we take an undirected graph, which of course simply consists of a bunch of points and an assignment of pairs, which are to be designated as edges. And as the problem sort of says, you want to sort of divide this set of vertices into two different sets, two distinct sets, in such a way that the number of edges that go from one subset of the vertices to the other subset of the vertices is maximized. Okay, so this is what is called a max cut problem. For a given graph, find the maximum cut. It has a lot of real applications which I will not worry about or go into. But this is a central problem. It is central partly because it has to again do with complexity theory. I mean, what people try to do is to understand whether a problem of one kind is equivalent to problem of another kind, and ultimately they all belong to whether these problems belong to a certain complexity class that I'll not bother to define. But very often the idea is, if you are trying to solve this problem using a machine, the question is, how hard is it? And whether how hard this problem is, that is the same as the hardness of some other problem. And in fact, when I run through this, you will see it reminds me of like when you talk about the Riemann hypothesis and then you start saying, well, the Riemann hypothesis is this, but this is equivalent to Riemann hypothesis. And something else is also equivalent to Riemann hypothesis. And the hope is ultimately that you get your hands on one of those things. So there are a whole lot of problems which, roughly speaking, have the same level of complexity, but that I will not talk about anymore. This is one of these central problems of determining what is called a max cot. So that's what I said, find the maximum of the number of edges that go from one set of vertices to the other set of vertices. So you keep partitioning in whatever way you like, but keep track, keep an account of, for a particular partition, how many edges go from one side to the other and maximize it. If you look at a bipartite graph where the edges by definition go from one set of vertices to another set of vertices, there is nothing more to do, because if you partition the vertices in any other way, the number of edges that go from one set to the other will actually only decrease. So the number of edges that you already have in a bipartite graph solves this problem. Okay, that's a simple example of what happens. And similarly, the max two coloring problem, that is that of coloring a graph so that no two different edges have the same color, is the same as asking for this max cot in a graph, okay? So this problem is equivalent to that one. Let's just look at what it means. So here is an example. So the next three slides simply demonstrate this. Here is an example of a graph with a bunch of vertices here and edges going between these vertices. So you can partition the graph, the vertices, either in this way or in that way, or maybe in some third way, maybe in some fourth way, and so on and so forth. And then each time you do it, you simply count how many edges are going across. So here there are 1, 2, 3, 4, and here there are 1, 2, and 3, which is illustrated, actually marked on this slide. So there are 4 edges here that go across. Here there are 3 edges that go across. So this is, this is something you can try to write an algorithm on a machine which can actually try to enumerate all the possibilities and then come up with an answer. Now, to relate it to various other things, let's see. Let's associate with this is my visual proof of the equivalence of this max cot problem to what is called a cot norm. Cot norm is a norm that you define on the set of matrices, and finding that norm is the same as solving the max cot problem. Okay, so you have a bunch of matrices, and on that you define a certain norm. To motivate that, one is so you have graphs, you have matrices, and the finding the norm of a certain matrix is the same as finding the max cot for the graph. So given a graph, I'm going to associate a matrix with it. So what is going to be the rule? We'll do it by example. So this is the one that's going to be by example, and as I said, it's a visual proof, whereas the Kirvine proof, we'll do it by writing down the details in the usual mathematical or the traditional sort of way. So here is a graph. It has 5 vertices, I guess, yeah, and a number of edges. Here I have, in the definition of the initial definition of the problem, I said you take an undirected graph. Here I'm taking these arrows, but this is only for defining the matrix. They have no particular role to play. So I first try to label the columns according to the vertices. So this blue corresponds to this vertex, this pink corresponds to this one, and so on and so forth, okay? And then what I do is I make 2 rows for each edge. So this is the edge number 1, and the rows that I make are identical, except the black box, I put a 1 if you like, and in this LO box I put a minus 1 and then I switch its role. Okay, that's the prescription. Go to the edge number 2. What happens there? Well, it's a edge between the blue and the green. So again, you put minus 1 here and a plus 1 here. That sort of is determined by sort of saying it's going to the blue as opposed to coming out of the blue. So it won't matter ultimately which way you put. You put here a minus 1, there a plus 1, but then switch the row. The important thing is if in this row you put minus 1, plus 1 here, then you turn it around. So now you do the same thing with 3, and I won't bother to tell you. You can guess what's happening here. You take any two of these vertices, and then you basically put a plus 1 and a minus 1 in the row corresponding to that edge, okay, joining these two vertices. Then repeat it, except with the position switched. Now, here is a notion of what is called a cut norm, which should sort of make you feel intuitively that it has something to do with the question of finding the maximum cut. What are you doing is to say that if you are given a matrix, here I am talking about everything that's real. We'll worry about the complex world afterwards. Right now, everything is real. So, so you have a real matrix, Aij, and you know its rows and columns are indices by its rows and columns are indexed by these sets R and S. It is not necessarily a square matrix. So you have R and S, two sets. You look at an arbitrary subset of rows and then another arbitrary subset of columns. Take the sum of all the entries of this matrix, absolute value, maximize over that, okay? Maximum over all possible subsets of the rows, all possible subsets of the columns, that gives you a norm which is called the cut norm. Now, what does that have to do with the graph? Well, that we'll see in a moment. The cut norm, which is defined this way, and the graph, which I have just now described to you, how to make. So given a graph, I have this matrix. The claim is that the cut norm of the matrix on the right is equal to the size of the maximum cut of this graph. Okay? So this is how you go from this graph to a norm of certain matrix that you associate with it. Now, as I said, this is a visual proof. This is actually from a paper of Noga Allen and Asaf Naur. If you look at their proof, it's actually two lines for an arbitrary graph and the associated matrix to that graph. In fact, even making up the actual a formal definition of the matrix from this pictorial description I have given you is a bit of a challenge, so to say. But they, of course, write down what the matrix is, given a vertex set and an edge set. It can all be done formally. That's what I'm saying. And the original paper from which this comes is by Allen and Naur. So, to prove this claim, you first prove that the cut norm is at least the size of the max cut. And then, of course, you will prove that the other way around, that is true too. So how do you do it? Well, let's look at this particular partition of the vertices. Namely, you take these two vertices here and these three vertices over there. Then what happens? Well, you sort of retain these columns that correspond to the blue vertex and the green vertex. Okay, the others don't matter now. Then you remove, all I want to say is that you are going to be able to make it so that the cut norm, you achieve at least the cut norm. So I'm going to give you a configuration. This is my graph. This is the partition that I'm working with. All I want to do is to give you a prescription that will produce the number of edges that are going out, namely 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, I want to just give a particular choice of the subset of the rows and a subset of the columns so that I get the answer 4. And I'm saying that if you think about it, the prescription I am giving you will actually work. So the three vertices that are left out here, forget them. Okay, that leaves you with these. And then, as you can see, the sixth edge doesn't matter because in what we left out, the plus minus ones are all gone. So, well, actually, I'm starting from edge two, and then you forget that. You forget the sixth one because it doesn't contribute. And then what is left is these black and yellow rows. Forget the second row, which has a minus sign. So if you do this, then what is finally left are these four rows. So this is a particular prescription. This is a particular prescription of the rows and columns that finally produces 4. And that 4 is the number of edges that are going out here. As I said, you can formalize this so that this prescription would look like actually an algorithm. And the point is, if you do this, you will conclude that the cut norm is at most the size of the max cut. Now, you have to prove that the cut norm is at most the size of the max cut, but then you have the other worry that, the cut norm is at most, yeah. The cut norm was less or equal to, is at least, yeah. So this is what I knew. This is at least because I have given you a prescription that produces the maximum number of cuts, okay? I have given you a prescription that produces the maximum number of cuts. Therefore, this cut norm is at least as much as the max cut, okay? So now I have to do it the other way around. The cut norm is at most the size of the max cut. And that, suppose somebody tells you that here is my prescription, how do I verify that he cannot come up, somebody cannot come up with a smart or intelligent configuration or a partition that gives me more than the max cut. That is what we have to see. So somebody gives you this, so these three columns, then it corresponds to this blue, pink, and green, okay? And then you have to see that if this is what is given, this is the partition, then you can do no better than the max cut. Well, in this, if you look at the, let me go back, if I look at 1, 2, 3, and these three vertices that are inside one partition, in the sum, because there are exactly as many pluses, as many as minuses, they will cancel out. So you might as well forget those. What remains is this zero, this sixth edge. Because of the two columns that have been left out, they have no plus one or minus one. So you might as well forget them. And what is left is, well, the best you can do. Sorry. The best you can do is, because there is a minus one and a minus one here, the best you can do while summing this is to forget these two rows so that you finally end up getting, the best you get is plus two. Okay? So what I'm saying is, if you go back and look at this and ask yourself what is the most number of ones you can retain, what can be the maximum of such a sum coming out of this, then you find that such a sum will be at most two. And that is, again, the max cut for this particular partition. And what I'm saying is, no matter how you partition it, such a prescription will tell you that the cut norm is going to be at most this, okay? The number of max cuts. So we have shown that the cut norm is at least the same as max cut, and then we have shown that it is at most the max cut, and therefore it is actually equal. As I said, this is sort of a pictorial depiction of what the proof is, and if you really want to see that this is the same thing, this expression here, Some maximized over this, and the definition of what I said, the max cut. You can actually look at the paper by Allen and Nowell. There is just a very short proof. Okay. Now I want to come to this question of saying, in this business, what actually is going on? So you start. I repeat it here a little bit. We start with the cut norm, which is norm A of C defined this way. Look at a matrix Aij. I is coming from some subset of the index, row index set. J is coming from some set of the column index set. And then you maximize this quantity. That's the cut norm. That's what we have seen. And that cut norm, as I began by saying, is actually the same as the max cut of a graph that you can associate with this matrix. Or starting from a graph, you can produce a matrix like this, and the max cut will be the same as this. Okay. So here is another interesting thing where I was trying to say that in this business, what people try to do is to sort of determine a level of difficulties, so to say. And the level of difficulty kind of question, in functional analysis at least, now switching gears to some other way of looking at things, is such an inequality. What it says is that, let's say we have another norm. Forget about what this norm is, which is of course defined here. But you have a matrix. We have just now defined a norm on that matrix. But suppose somebody gives you another norm, okay? Take the max of the rows, and then take the max over all possible rows. So that will give you a number, and it will be some kind of a norm. Question is, how do two norms compare? Is one norm too far away from another norm? Is this norm close to some other norm, and so on and so forth? This is essentially captured by inequalities like this. Whenever you have two norms that satisfy an inequality of this sort with some constant here, and you are also allowed to put another constant here. So there are two constants, and one of these norms with this constant and another constant over here is related in this manner. Then we say that those norms are kind of comparable. They are equivalent, is what one says. In this particular case, it turns out the cut norm, as we have just now seen, has this root, if you like, in graph theory. Whereas in functional analysis or finite dimensional linear algebra, there is a more familiar thing. There is a more commonplace norm that you use in day-to-day life, namely, take a matrix Aij and do this summation, Ajk, Sj, Tk, where Sj and Tk are absolute value 1. As I said, for the talk today, I am in the real world. In the complex world, this will be defined slightly differently. And the story, generally speaking, and somewhat surprisingly in this particular case, is different when you are dealing with the complex field versus when you are talking about the real field. There are distinctions which are kind of surprising. But right now, you define this L infinity to L1 norm by saying it's almost like this, except you have a sign that you have thrown in. Now, the question is, how much does that change, the final answer? Well, it turns out it doesn't change very much. It's actually the cut norm times 4 greater or equal to this, greater or equal to that. In fact, there is another interesting thing that I did not include in these slides, that given A, you can actually produce a B, so that the cut norm will be four times the cut norm will be actually this norm, equal, not greater or equal, but equal. However, here, it won't be the same A, but you will construct a B out of A, which is not very different. You just add one row and one column. Given A, you produce this B so that the infinity one norm of the B will actually be the four times the cut norm of A. This, as I said, is a very, very familiar norm. What it is saying is that look at Rn with L infinity norm and Rn with L1 norm, and then you compute what we call the operator norm, and that's the expression here. But the main point is that they are comparable, and here is a very quick proof. If you want to say that this is four times something or the other, since you are dealing with Sj absolute value, Tk absolute value equal to 1, these are actually plus minus 1s. And therefore, in writing down this norm, this particular norm, you can write it as a sum of four different things, where the Sj and Tk are both 1, where Sj, Tk are 1 and minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, and then another minus 1, 1. So that's actually the proof. You write it in, separate it out into four pieces, you'll get four sums like this, but the absolute value of each of the four terms in the right-hand side is at most, because remember, this is the sum that we are looking at. Now these are positive terms, so we don't need the absolute value, and therefore it is each one of these is AC. So by using triangle inequality, you'll see that this norm is actually at most four times that. Now, this is also from the paper of Allen and Noether. So I must be sure. Let me make a declaration. There's nothing here that I'm saying is new, and I have just taken stuff from here and there. Many years ago, Bhaskar and I were interested in this. There is one little thing at the very end I'll point out, but there is really nothing new here. But these things are very, very recent. Actually, this is this discussion of the Allen and Noether paper perhaps is no more than 8 or 9 years old. So now similarly, to get the other inequality, you simply define two new vectors, if you like, xi equal to 1 for I in the index set that you have chosen, and xi equal to minus 1 otherwise. So similarly for y, you define yj to be equal to 1 if j is in the index set j, minus 1 otherwise. Write down this expression, aij, this cut norm is actually equal to this. If you again sort of think about it for a second, you will see that this is actually the sum because of the way that we have written. But you split it up into four parts and then observe, like in the previous slide, then each one of these is at most the L infinity L1 norm, and therefore L infinity L1 norm, again by the triangle inequality, will have to be greater or equal to the cut norm. So this is actually what I want to say. What have we done? We have said, from a certain point of view, the world was interested in finding the cut norm because they were interested in finding the max cut. Okay, max cut leads to the cut norm, and then you come in and say, oh, well, but what is this cut norm? We know it. It is actually the infinity one norm, and then you say infinity one norm is more or less the same as the cut norm. But solving this problem in the language of computer science, I want to mention these two terms, is called an integer linear programming problem, for whatever reason that I don't understand fully. And the way they go about doing their business is somewhat counterintuitive from the point of view of the way I think, or some of us think. This integer linear programming problem, as we have just now seen, is related to the cut norm and the max cut problem. But you might say then that we may simply wish to compute this, and this is actually a computation that people in functional analysis should be very familiar with. And you say, well, what's the big deal? Let's just compute L infinity to L1 norm. And of course, there are difficulties there. Until you actually think about it, you don't realize how difficult this can be. Okay? And that's where this complexity class comes in. The max cut or the cut norm problem is the same level of difficulty as this infinity one norm computation problem. So anyway, this is somehow not easy. And therefore you say, and this is where, of course, the genius of Grothendieck comes in. You are faced with a problem that you find hard to do, and this is where intuition from theoretical computer science and intuition from mathematics, they seem to go the wrong way around. I don't quite understand. Maybe you can make some sense of it. In the 60s, Grothendieck walks in, sees that here is a problem that's hard to solve. What does he do? He says, well, I can't solve this simple problem. Let me try to solve a harder problem. And he sets himself a harder problem to solve. But in the language of computer science, they call it a relaxation. I don't know why they call it a relaxation, but what I think of as a harder problem, they say relaxation, as you see. So Grothendieck says, well, give ourselves a little bit more room so that we can compute this norm. Okay? How does he do it? Well, here is what is called the two-summing norm, and it really doesn't matter what name you give. So this is where the language becomes very conflicting. The LP relaxation is what they say. In other words, they are looking for solutions where the solutions in the previous problem, what they call the integer programming problem, have to be plus one, minus one. The solution set is no good if it is not plus one, minus one. Whereas in this problem, the solution comes from a Hilbert space, which means that you cannot ensure that it is a vector consisting of plus one, minus one. And to that extent, I don't know, I mean, they call it a relaxation because you give yourself more room. And so the problem now, let's just examine. It is the same poor old A that is sitting there. But what you do is, instead of looking at a SITJ, which is a very simple thing to do, you say that, well, let me put in XJ inner product YK, where XJ and YK are unit vectors from a Hilbert space. Now imagine, before it was just a plus one, minus one. Of course, they are unit vectors in L infinity norm and something, but it doesn't matter. They were very simple. Here now, your degree of difficulty has increased quite a bit because it's a much larger supremum problem that you are trying to solve. You have put in these vectors, arbitrary vectors from the unit ball of a Hilbert space. Now, what Grothendieck defined many, many years ago, and as I said, this whole business was dormant until about 10, 15 years ago when people in computer science picked up this idea. So, and used, if you like, this term and so on and so forth. Grothendieck defined what is now known as the Grothendieck constant to be the number, well, the supremum of all this while you hold this fixed. Not fixed, while you run over these matrices A, whose infinity one norm is at most one. So let's again remind ourselves that you are actually trying to compare the infinity one norm, how good or bad it is, relative to this two-summing norm. Two-summing norm is allowing all these vectors from the Hilbert space, unit vectors, whereas this was over scalars. And so this is the definition. Supremum of everything that you do like this, but over L infinity one norm. This constant depends on the ground field, but the interesting thing is it remains finite as n goes to infinity. That's the main point of the Grothendieck discovery, or what is called the Grothendieck inequality. The Grothendieck constant is this one, which basically says, like before, this two-summing norm and L infinity L1 norm are again comparable. Okay? It's just a constant. This huge computation differs from this simple computation by a constant. And that is amazing. That is really amazing. It's a universal constant, and it is not known, of course. So this is known to be the differ by a constant factor. The exact value of kg is not known. What is also interesting is that these constants, you would have imagined they would be strictly increasing. Surprisingly, they are not. In other words, the real Grothendieck constant for for size 2 matrices and size 3 matrices is square root of 2. In the complex case, it is 1. And the Grothendieck constant is known to be bigger than 1. What I'm going to do in the next, the remaining part of this lecture is to show you this proof. So Kirvine gives a proof that says that the Grothendieck constant can be no more than this. And he actually conjectured that this is the best bound, and for various reasons of connection with problems in computer science, there has been a very, very strong interest in computing actually this constant. And it's unbelievable that when some of the computer scientists were able to improve this constant in the fourth decimal place or the fifth decimal place, that was a big excitement only 3 or 4 years ago. This is also one of those unusual situations where the lower bound and the upper bound differ by very little. Okay? Typically, when you are looking at a situation like this, the lower and upper bound have a rather visible gap. In this case, the gap is very little, and yet nobody knows what exactly is the constant.
You said G is the ground field, but you put R
and... Oh, where did I say G?
Oh, G for...
Yeah.
Now,
yeah, right. Yeah, R or C is on top. Okay.
KGC1 is 1. Is that very easy to see?
Huh?
KGC1 is 1.
Is it? No, that's easy to see.
That's easy to see.
Yeah. That will be sort of, we can write that down. It's not, that's easy to see. Now let's see. LP relaxation, this. So I'll finish before I start the proof. There are just a couple of more things that I want to say. Namely, why is this big interest in Grothendieck or this inequality? The graphs with which I started, actually now what is done usually is to define what is called a Grothendieck constant for a graph. Okay? And you define it in this way. So you start by picking a graph which is on n vertices, and of course it has an edge set. Then Nogalan, Asaf Naur, and many, many other people working with them, collaborators and others, have finally agreed that this is a natural definition to make, namely to say that the Grothendieck constant is the K, universal K, which occurs in this inequality. In other words, as before, you write down Aij, Xi, inner product Yj, where Ijs come from that edge set. And these Xis are unit vectors. Xi and Yjs are unit vectors. And similarly, Aij, Si, Tj, Si absolute value 1, Tj absolute value 1. This holds true for all real matrices A. So you are running over, or this inequality, if you like, you can put one of these on the other side and do a maximization problem. But this inequality is over all real matrices. The graph is fixed. The graph is fixed simply determines the size of the matrix and the edge set over which you are summing. Okay? So this is what is called the Grothendieck constant for a graph. The original Grothendieck inequality is the particular case that corresponds to bipartite graphs, and as a consequence, you have the supremum over bipartite graphs on n vertices gives you that nth level Grothendieck constant that I had defined, and then taking the supremum, you get a finite constant. But this has the advantage that while the bipartite graphs are in one corner, the small set, you can now play with other kinds of graph. At the other extreme are graphs like the complete graph on n vertices. And then what is known is that the Grothendieck constant for a complete graph is of the order of log n, which is, as you can see, dependent on n and is very different from the universal constant that we talked about before. Okay, so I couldn't help resist put in this slide. Now I am not going to say anything. I'll let you just look at it. Apparently, there are connections with statistical physics and such, which is of course something that I don't understand at all, but I felt obliged to put it in. I don't think I am ever going to sort of investigate where this leads, but this is actually from a survey paper by Gilles Godefroy, which appeared in the European Mathematical Society bulletin or something like that, very recently, actually a year ago. Okay, so of course, from my point of view, doing a maximum, I mean, it goes back to the same thing of finding the L infinity L1 norm. And well, there are, all that this is saying is there are reasons why one should be computing that norm. Okay, all right. So now I like to finish by telling you this beautiful proof of the Grothendieck inequality by Kirvine. This is actually from the 70s and involves essentially three ideas. You can see that this lemma already is like the Grothendieck inequality. What it is saying is that if you have these Aij's, by putting in something non-linear involving ui, vj, this is actually the unit sphere in some Hilbert space, if you like, you are able to bound this quantity with the vectors with a scalar quantity. Okay, but the trouble is, unlike in the Grothendieck inequality, this is non-linear. So the next couple of lemmas linearize what is non-linear in this main inequality. Okay, so well, the proof is that we take a, there is by the way a probabilistic way of doing this whole thing, which I again find hard to read or understand, but there is, I mean, this is some kind of a expectation of some random variable or something, and the whole thing can be done in that language which I am not familiar with. But but you know, first you evaluate this integral, signum xu and signum yu, where x and y are vectors fixed in the unit sphere, and then u is the variable of integration. So what you are saying is this integral is actually 1 minus 2 psi over pi, where psi can be given as, psi can be shown to be this cosine inverse x inner product y. I'll just say a couple of steps of this thing. The verification, actually, this is a n-dimensional integral, but by using the fact that if you take a measure which is invariant under unitary transforms, like Lebesgue measure on Rn, then what you can do is to say that these vectors x and y that are there, you can take them to be, although they were arbitrary vectors, x and y, you can take them to be vectors of this form, okay? Where the psi is given by this cosine inverse x comma y, sine inverse x comma y. So this happens because when I am computing this integral, I can do a change of variable by setting u of little u to be my new variable. And this ux taking to be this and ui taking to be that is obtained by doing what is called a Gram-Schmidt. You take the xy and make a Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization so that your first vector goes to, I have described this here, so let's just look at this. If x and y are linearly independent, either they are equal. If they are equal, you have nothing to do. But if they are linearly dependent, x is equal to minus 1 minus y, then you take u to be this, u y to be that, and psi is pi. Okay. Similarly, if x is equal to y, then you do that and you still have this unitary transformation. If x and y are linearly independent, then apply Gram-Schmidt. And if you apply Gram-Schmidt, you will be able to obtain a pair of orthonormal vectors, alpha 1 and alpha 2, in Rn, but extend alpha 1 and alpha 2 to a full orthonormal basis and define u of alpha 1 to be this, u of alpha 2 to be that. Okay, so you are thinking of your orthonormal elements, the first two orthonormal elements to be the standard unit vectors in Rn. And when you do that and go back to calculate, where does x go and where does y go? I suppose I have written that down also. A simple calculation then gives ux remains where it was, that is 1, 0, 0, whereas y, u of y becomes cosine psi and sine psi 0, 0, 0. Okay? Therefore, in computing this ux inner product uy and yy inner product uu, we assume without loss of generality that this vector, remember this u is our variable, but now we can assume this vector to be cosine theta, sine theta and zeros everywhere else because the vector against which you are taking inner product has only two non-zero entries. Okay? So after you do that, then you go back to your integral, ask yourself, what is the integral? Well, you replace x and u and y and u, everything by u of x, u of u and so on and so forth. And as I said, the integral is invariant. And after a little bit of trigonometry, you end up getting this signum of cosine theta, signum of cosine theta minus psi d theta. This integral is what you are trying to do. The answer to that integral is 1 minus 2 psi over pi. But because of what we have taken to be psi, it ends up being this. The only thing that remains is to see what is this integral. Now, again, a formal proof will take a while. But if you think of where your theta is and where your psi is, I have written down x instead of a theta. So if you look at this picture, it's a product of plus 1, minus 1. That's where this is, sine cosine theta, sine cosine theta minus x. So if you look at this product is plus 1 when theta lies in the red and minus 1 when theta lies in the green. If you put that together, you will get that integral to be what I claim. But the Aij, Sitj, our hypothesis was summation Aij, Sitj is less or equal to 1 in absolute value. But that means by taking Si to be signum of Ui inner product X and Tj to be signum of Vj inner product X, I can write this sum to be bigger or equal to minus 1, less or equal to plus 1, and the choice of vectors for any choice of unit vectors. Now to complete the proof, all I do is integrate. If I integrate, then I find that this sum is less or equal to pi over 2, okay? So that's one part of the story. And as I said, it's almost done except for the fact that this is somehow not quite linear. So we'll fix that. This is a very interesting technique where you want to say that you can actually take an inner product to the power k and write it as a linear thing like this. So there is a mapping wk such that, you know, wk x, wk inner product y is x inner product y to the power k. Now, well, this is actually a fairly straightforward proof because wk x can be simply taken to be the k-fold tensor product of the vector x. That's your map. Given a vector x, just take a k-fold tensor product. And So this is to verify this, it just uses the definition of the tensor product. If you have a tensor product of x tensor y inner product with x tensor y, then it's the x inner product x times y inner product y. That's what this lemma is. But now you do a little bit something that is somewhat more imaginative. you sort of say, given a positive number C, that was our problem, right? I mean, there is a sign that occurred in our previous. Yeah, this sign is what we are trying to get rid of, because I want something that involves just ordinary inner products of vectors rather than this nonlinear function. So here is a lemma that uses basically a Taylor series expansion of the sine function. So you say that given a positive number C, you define this U from L to N to, now this L2 is the infinite dimensional Hilbert space, V is again L to N to little L2. So Ux inner product Vy. So U from here, and U from this vector X here, V Y from here. So you take their inner product, you will get sine C of X comma Y. This can be arranged, is what one is saying, by taking Ux norm square. U is a vector such that Ux norm square is sine hyperbolic of Cx norm square. Vy norm square is sine hyperbolic C norm Y square. That's the only condition. But you are able to convert a nonlinear function into essentially a linear thing. And this follows from that tensor product remark that I made and using high school algebra, namely sine C x comma y as a function has a Taylor series expansion, okay? This x inner product y. So in this Taylor series expansion, you see you have x inner product y to the power k. But this x inner product y to the power k can be written by using that w that I had written before. And ck, of course, is the Taylor coefficient. Once you have this, to arrive at what I want, ux inner product y to be equal to this, you simply choose your vectors correctly. Okay? So that will do that. And now we will complete the proof. What is the proof? The proof is to show that there is a universal constant that tells you aij xi inner product yj absolute value soup is at most aij si tj with a certain constant. So to be able to do that, take c to be this. I mean, you want to find that constant. What is a constant that works? So take c to be sine hyperbolic, because that's the one that came here, and you take C to be sine hyperbolic inverse 1, which is ln 1 plus root 2, and make your choices. The rest of it is actually a computation. Namely, we know that in the previous slide, we saw that C xi inner product yj can be written this way, and then you substitute, okay? And that will give you aij summation from the first lemma, less or equal to pi over 2, and substitute this, you will get that, okay? I mean, with the 2 minutes remaining, I just want to finish by saying that the Grothendieck constant, of course, makes its appearance in various places, and there is a inequality of Bharpalos that said that the Grothendieck inequality in computing another obtaining the solution to another extremal problem involving polynomials of a commuting tuple of operators. This is the operator norm here, and this supremum bounded below by the Grothendieck constant, bounded above by 2 times the Grothendieck constant. And the reason I want to say this here, and I finish with this, is that Bharpalos had made an interesting conjecture saying that the 2 that he is getting on the right hand side is a limitation of his proof, rather than actually a necessity. So he conjectured that the 2 on the right can be removed. And if you could remove the 2 on the right, according to him, he proposed a alternative to computing the Grothendieck constant. And it turns out that that's not quite true. First of all, it was improved. So, okay, you can forget all that. The point is that that constant, what happened to that constant? Right. So that constant, which is there in this this slide 2, it can actually be made into 3 root 3 over 4. That is a huge improvement on this constant 2. This was done by Rajiv Gupta while writing his PhD. In his PhD thesis, this inequality was given. But what is more interesting, which I didn't put in, it is sort of rather unfortunate, I should have added. After his PhD, he together with Samya Kumar Ray, were able to show that not only that this is an improvement, you cannot make this 1. I mean, he was able to get it to be 3 root 3 over 4, which is less than 2. But the question of Bharpalos was, can you actually make it less or equal to just the constant without, just the Grothendieck constant without any factor here? And these two young mathematicians have shown now that that cannot be done. In other words, the Grothendieck constant cannot be computed using this extremal problem, at least as was proposed by Bharpalos 30 or 35 years ago. So that's it. Thank you.
Time for a few questions.
So you mentioned over Greek complex, this constant is bound in Kirvines.
Yeah.
There's no analogous thing for real?
No. So the constant and the proof that I showed is actually for real. And there is a, as usual, fairly trivial way of saying that if you have a universal constant that works in the real case, you can find a universal constant that will work for the complex. But the problem always in this particular topic has been not to just show that there is a constant, but to actually find what that constant is or approximating that constant. As far as that is concerned, Kirvine's proof was sitting there in isolation again for 30 odd years, until Burge picked it up a few years ago and tried to make up a proof along the lines of the original Kirvine proof, but in the complex case, okay? And it does involve a fairly non-trivial kind of generalization. Things don't go through as it is. So he had to really work hard to produce a similar bound, but in the complex case, after 30 odd years of the original proof of Kirvine, which was given for real.
And these are things simpler if you look at just some finite
integer. Yeah, that I think between real and complex, people are sort of caught up in this. But if you look at finite field, you have to modify the nature of your question. Here, everything is about asymptotics. And over a finite field, those kind of questions, I think, will collapse. I mean, will not really make sense.
The N-by-N matrices you can talk of
within. Yeah, but you see, what I'm trying to say is you can talk about their entries, but now when I look at Aij, Si, Tj, as I was saying, if it is a finite field and I'm writing down this sum, a lot of those things might end up becoming zero. Because I don't have places to go and so on and so forth. But what I believe is that here everything is about a combinatorial optimization which has some kind of infinity built into it. Whereas in the finite field case, I have a feeling that it will still be a combinatorial problem of a similar nature, but that going off to infinity kind of part will not be there. That's what I feel. I mean, because finally, after a while, things will start becoming zero and stuff. So, I mean, for example, one could change this by making all kinds of assumptions with on the class of matrices that you are talking about, which I did not do. For example, instead of looking at arbitrary matrices, you can look at symmetric or positive definite and so on and so forth. And each one of them give rise to a new, as I said, in the computer science language, it looks like it's a question about complexity class. I mean, you can change the problem. The question is, have you changed the hardness of the problem? And if they are equivalent, then that's good. And then you hope to be able to find a problem that's equivalent and tractable or something like that. Yeah, but.
So what is the relation? I've heard this is to do with this Subhash quote.
Ah, that's right. Yeah, yeah. Right, right. So there's a whole lot. Yeah, in fact, I was trying to. I'm certainly not an expert, but in some variations, again, it becomes the same thing that you. From a computational point of view, there is the unique games conjecture, and like here we talked about the max cut problem and so on. You will say that if you could solve this problem, then you can solve that problem, and vice versa. So the level of, you know, algorithmically speaking, they are comparable problems in some sense. Yeah, Subhash Code definitely with Asaf Nawar and Subhash Code, they have substantial contributions to this area actually. Yeah.
You mentioned that the infinity to one norm is bounded above and below by the LP relaxed norm.
Yeah, that's correct. That's right. That's right.
So
that's
are those strict bounds four times?
I think the point of the Grothendieck constant is that, I mean, that they have to be strict. Okay. Yeah. Otherwise, the Grothendieck constant will end up becoming one in some sense. So yeah, I think it is strict. Yeah. In fact, on one side, the actual bound will be the Grothendieck constant, the upper Grothendieck constant. On the other side, it will be the lower Grothendieck constant. Yeah.
Question: why is that? Suppose the matrix, the arbitrary real matrix, as possible, diagonalized.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think so. Yeah, I think so. But I haven't actually thought about it. But I believe that if you make your class to be diagonalizable matrices, you would be able to do everything that we are talking about here by hand and come up with things that are much, much more concrete than what was said. Yeah. But I think. For instance, the difficulty will be, as I said, to say that the Grothendieck constant is strictly bigger than one is not entirely trivial. And for instance, you would imagine, let us say, restrict to diagonalizable matrices, and then you compute this thing. And you hope that constant will become bigger than one, so that way you will prove at least the lower bound is not, But I don't think you will be able to do it with diagonalizable matrices, because it will end up becoming one, is what I think. Yeah.
The question is, that perhaps, you mentioned that you constructed a partition function.
Yeah, right. Right.
And I think you alluded to the fact that this can be a random matrix.
Yeah, that's right.
So you take the logarithm of this.
Yeah. Yeah. I really don't know. I mean, the random matrix part, I haven't anything that has to do with it. There is a whole world over there that sort of deals with it, and some of the very best people with all kinds of good mathematics are looking at such questions. But I am hardly familiar, so I don't get in there. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, so what do you mean by the infinite dimensional?
The underlying space instead of R and
something. Yeah. I think you can make a formulation, and I suspect in this particular case, your reformulation involving the infinite dimensional underlying space will not be actually different from the one that we are talking about. Because this n, so that's why there are several ways. There are two things that are, so I take n by n matrices acting on Rn, but when I go to the bringing vectors from a Hilbert space, that I can bring from a finite dimensional vector space or an infinite dimensional vector space. So depending on that, there are two, three different kinds of dependence on n that you make. You can hold the size of the matrices fixed, but bring your vectors from an infinite dimensional space. On the other hand, you can hold the dimension of the Hilbert space fixed and allow the size of the matrices to go off to whatever. But I think this is only an approximation scheme for the infinite dimensional situation. So I think in one go, you can write down everything for an infinite dimensional setup. It's just that some of these subtleties will be lost, but I don't think you will get anything new. Okay. Yeah.
In representation theory, is it useful to think about this Grothendieck?
I mean, I don't know.
Because, I mean, abstract group, you're right. I mean, yeah. Thinking of it as a matrix.
Yeah. Yeah, that's actually not a bad idea, but nobody seems to have talked about it yet. So that might be an interesting avenue for research as far as I can see. Because everybody is so caught up in this complexity business that complexity and the probabilistic, you know, the random matrix theory and so on. But nobody has gone into aspects where you talk about representations of a group and then see if there is to that group, whether there is a Grothendieck constant associated and then how they compare and so on. That will be a very interesting thing to do, actually, I feel. I mean, okay, yeah.
What was Grothendieck's motivation?
Oh, that I should have said. A one-line motivation. If you are looking at Banach space operators from L infinite to L1 in his case, so you have this given operator going from L infinity to L1, and one knows that somehow Hilbert space in that scheme of things, when you are going from L1 to L infinity, somewhere along the way there is L2, which is a very nice space. Grothendieck's motivation was, if I give you an operator that goes between these two Banach spaces, when can I find an operator that goes to a Hilbert space and comes back from that Hilbert space? And this original operator is a product, composition of these two, without increasing the norm. That was his thing. So this finite constant tells you that you can find, you can typically perhaps find two operators. But then what will happen to norms is not clear. What he is saying is that there is a universal constant, so that given any operator going from L infinity to L1, you would be able to find a Hilbert space operator going down, coming up, in such a way that the composition is actually the original operator, but the norm bounds haven't been disturbed too much. This operator going down, that operator coming up, are bound by to the original operator norm by some small constant. Yeah.
All right, if there are no more questions, let's thank the speaker again.
Yeah, thank you.